Test 1 2 test 1 2 testing 1 2 1 2 test.
Welcome to Conversations Over Chess Podcast. I'm your host Elijah. Coming to sit down over a game of chess with me is an individual who actually inspired this podcast. He's somebody I called a friend of mine. And before I introduce him, let me get a couple things out of the way. First, gotta pay the bills, our sponsorship. So our sponsor for this video is Kansas Consulting Group. They are a boutique consulting firm that specializes in everything from small to medium-sized firms and anything transportation, healthcare, and financials. So be sure to check them out, Kansas Consulting Group. And again, without further ado, introducing Salvador. Pleasure to have you, Sal.
Thank you.
Pleasure to be here.
All right. Here to play a game of chess and have a great conversation.
Yes, sir.
As my guest, you get to go first of always. So you'll get to play as white, and then I'll play as black.
All right.
All right.
Say less.
How's your day going today?
So far, so good. Can't complain.
It's always good. That's always good. So you know you're about to take an L, right?
We're going to see about that. See if I still remember how to set up the board.
I was going
to
say, a lot of people is watching, so don't set up the wrong way, because that would be a little embarrassing. Just a little bit. Let's see. It's all right. You could just move with me. Oh. There you go. Now help you out. There. So, as always, first question is obviously, who taught you how to play the game of chess?
Who taught me how to play? I mean, I think I first learned in high school. There was this little kind of chess, little setup area in the cafeteria during lunch. So there was a guy teaching. He wasn't teaching me in particular. I was more always just stepping back and watching everybody.
Okay.
But after a little bit, I decided to get in there, and after some trial and error and a couple of games and, you know, experience, I started becoming a little bit good. Just not good enough to remember how to set up a chessboard. So it's just
all right. Was there anybody in that time frame that was like, hey, this individual, I just can't beat them, and then you ended up eventually beating them at some point, or can't remember back that far?
I mean, I can remember, I just don't remember playing them enough. I don't remember playing them enough to have that much of an impact when I did play them. So it was like I played maybe one or two games in the third game, boom, you know, checkmate.
Okay.
So I haven't really had a noticeable like figure that stood in the way of chess, if you will.
Okay. Besides me.
Yeah, besides you.
I'm just fine. All right, that's good. And where are you originally from?
Born and raised in DC, Northwest area around Columbia Heights, just below Georgia Ave.
Chocolate City.
Mm-hmm.
As we say, how has DC been to you?
Man, for the most part, pretty good, but it definitely has its moments.
All right.
Yeah.
What are those moments that you're speaking of?
I don't know, man. Just growing up. Check. When I say those moments, I'm referring to. See, like I'm too focused on this, on these answers, man. I ain't even.
It's all right.
Yeah, we won't have to.
We're sure we'll get a couple games in.
Yeah, I didn't see that. You already moved?
Yeah, I'm gonna actually push this knight.
Man.
So you were saying what it was those things we were talking about when they were good or bad in regards to DC?
Growing up, I wouldn't say that I grew up in the hood, if you will, but okay. I've just always been around that. It's hoods everywhere. And DC's a little bit different in the sense that it's not really much sort of like a set. It's more so like a block. That's why mm-hmm. it's just a little too violent here. It's you from this block, you can be from the next block over, and it's still like stuff. Like it doesn't make sense. But basically, I've had friends that I've seen, you know, die, or just, you know, just growing up in an environment where everyone like your age is out here like selling drugs and, you know, toting guns and this, yeah, that, and third. So. And then just being involved in stuff when you're just trying to, you know, stay away from it. So it has its times. I mean, another thing about DC is it's so small that it's literally a small world.
Sure.
But you know what? I don't know if I could do this, man. I don't know if I could talk to you because I'm like focused on what I'm saying. It's not.
It's a small world. I'm pretty sure I got confidence you can multitask, but okay. It's a small world.
Yeah. Well, they take my rook. But yeah, there's like that little effect.
So it seems like more than anything, it's about being in proximity. So you may not necessarily be involved in the nonsense, but more in the proximity of the nonsense, you can get caught up in things.
Correct.
Okay. So being caught up in things, you obviously alluded to losing things. And obviously the slogan of, you know, Conversations Over Chess podcast is every loss is a lesson. Right. So what lessons have you learned in your losses that you may have taken across, you know, however X amount of years you are?
That's a good question. So I definitely feel like throughout everything that has happened up until this point in time that I have learned a lot. I guess one of the biggest things that I've learned is, you know, try to bring your friends up with you.
Okay.
In the sense that, you know, we all want to do better for ourselves out here, and whether it be just financially or career progression or just overall health, like be there for the people that you care about in those moments, because no matter how small the thing may be, not doing something or doing something the wrong way could lead to an outcome that, you know, no one has ever wanted to see. So definitely if I could say something, I say that.
All right, helping others. So what do you say to, again, just playing devil's advocate, what do you say to those individuals who say, hey, look, don't hire your friends and family, they'll be the downfall of you? What is your rebuttal you would say to something like that?
I mean, when it comes to friends and family, specifically more on the family side, it could be a little touchy subject because, you know, not a lot of people have the best families in the sense that, you know, relationships aren't as, I want to say, what's the word I want to use here? Basically, they don't have like a good relationship with folks, and that's understandable. But I guess it really just depends on who we're talking about. You can't really lead a horse to water and expect for them to drink from it. It's more so, is this something that they also want, that you want for them? So, and if so, and you think that they're not at that level, I say train them to get to that level. And, you know, I got a friend myself, you know, I'm here at this firm. I got here through a program, work development program. And
so you definitely on the grind. Okay.
Yeah, for sure. And I got them to a place where they were able to, you know, get a solid interview in, and they did great. And now I'm coaching them. So, and before they couldn't do that, like all they knew was, you know, just restaurant job work. And they're not too book smart or too into like the corporate climate or whatnot. So, you know, I got them to that space. So I feel like it's just a matter of them wanting it and you wanting them for it. And what are we going to do to get to that level where you can do it for yourself?
Okay.
That's what I think.
Do you find it at times that you're working harder than they are, meaning that you want it more than them?
I mean, that's a difficult question because it really just depends on how hungry we both are. Like, you know, I could say I'm hungry, he could say he's hungry, but there's no real way to measure that.
Okay.
You know, I guess it really just depends in terms of our actions, considering where I'm at versus where he's at, you know, two different stages. He's just starting out. I'm about to finish and I'm trying to see if I'm going to get contracted or not. So it's hard to say, but I can definitely say he has that drive for sure.
How has your favorite chess piece on the board taught you, and if it has at all, anything about life? All right. This is the game of life. They say we get to play it twice. So what has this game taught you about real life?
Your moves matter, no matter how small, no matter how insignificant, no matter if you have defense, if you have offense, anything that you do, it comes around. I gotta watch out for that queen right there.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about the queen, man.
We're gonna do this. But yeah, just moves matter, no matter how big, no matter how small.
Moves matter. I'll go check. All right. One thing I think that I take away from the chess game is that we see that there's some pieces that I already captured, right? So let's just say you come back and win this game. You still won, but these pieces over here didn't make it. Like, they didn't stay on the board to finish the game, right?
Man.
So one thing that chess has taught me about life in general is that not everybody's gonna make it to that end game, right? The end game is to win, right? In this game is to put them in checkmate. But
Right.
whatever that end game is for an individual, this has taught me that not everybody's gonna make it. And it's good, bad, and it's at times I had a problem dealing with that because I'm an individual who wants everybody to win, right?
Right.
But it was a hard pill to swallow when you realize that not everybody can.
I just feel like I've been working, man, since as long as I can remember. Just growing up, I've had to mature a lot quicker than I wanted to.
Okay.
And that's because my family relies on me a lot. Like, first generation Salvadoran American. Both my parents, they from El Salvador, but they escaped. They fled to this country. They immigrated because there was a war going on at the time. They were still young at the time. My dad was like probably like in second grade.
I believe that's me.
Yeah, that's mate. And we're gonna run it
Yeah,
back. We're gonna run it
good
back. We're gonna
game,
run it
good
back.
game.
Right,
Okay.
so
So growing up fast, that's something I can relate to as well.
yeah.
What was your circumstance that had to grow fast? White goes first.
My circumstance was, I don't know, just the reality of my situation. They fled the country at a young age. Like, my dad can't read or write, so I've been reading his bills, whatever, mail, helping out. And you think I have an older brother, so he'd help with the load. But he's autistic, so it's kind of like, what much can he do to the point that there's like an impact on a beneficial impact on everybody? Plus, at the time, my half sister, she was out the picture. Something going on with them, like early on, like just not a good family relationship. So in the end, it all falls on me. But yeah, just the reality of the situation.
How has that affected you today in regards of relationships, just growth and projection in your own personal career, both work-wise, health-wise, things like that? How has that having to be a man early on in your life, affect you right now as a young man? How old are you?
Currently, I'm 21.
21. So being 21, having to be essentially the man of the house, right?
Yeah.
How has that affected you now?
I feel like it has its goods and bads to it. Bads being that I couldn't really enjoy my childhood, or I wasn't doing like what a child would normally do. And goods in the sense that, I feel like I'm a wiser soul. Like, I'm more in tune to what it is that I have to done get done and like, just focus on. Like, it matured me to the point where I've set goals for myself early on when other people would just be thinking about whatever else they're thinking about in their 20s or going to school. Like, you see where I'm at now. I'm trying to get a career here in IT, just starting off for sure. I can't tell you that I'm at where I want to be, but the point is I've taken the steps to get there versus other people who are probably not even, in a similar situation.
Understood. So, what does Salvador want to do then? What do you want to do? Like, what is you're grown, right? You're the man of the house. You have these goals. What is it that you want to accomplish?
You know how Goku can go Super Saiyan, Super Saiyan 2, Super Saiyan 3?
Yes.
I want to get to Ultra Instinct, but in terms of independency. And when I
Okay.
say that, I mean I want to not have to rely on anyone, and I want to be put in a position where the people that I care for now, they're at a good spot where they don't need to rely on anyone either, so I can basically attend to myself and pursue the motive of the day. Do I want to go here, Saturday? Do I want to travel to, Europe and tour for like a week, like,
Okay.
just travel, like,
So you want to own your time is what I'm
right.
hearing. You want to own your time more than anything.
Make the best use of it while I still have it.
Okay. So what other losses have you taken that has brought more lessons in your life?
Oh man, I want to say the biggest loss that I've taken is Like recently, for sure too. I lost a good friend of mine this year, last year, like around August at the time that I started this internship.
Okay. Sorry to hear that.
Yeah,
How did
thank
you
you.
lose him?
He was living his life, man. He was just a little too free than he should have been. He passed driving under the influence, and he was on a motorcycle,
Yeah.
and on top of that with no helmet.
Ooh.
And I don't really know too much about the whole logistics of the situation.
Yeah.
I just knew that at the time he was drunk. At the time he had someone else with him too on a bike, and they had the helmet. And I think that they were on one of the highways, and they were trying to get to like VA. I don't know which road it was, whatever the case may be, but
Yeah.
I think he was riding with someone else. They're not sure on what happened either, quite exactly. But I think he saw something that looked like could have been a road, and he ended up hitting a barrier. And yeah, man, just got hit.
Yeah.
Tried to get up. He died on his knees. I think he collapsed both of his lungs, so he couldn't breathe, and he was still trying to stand up.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the biggest loss that I learned from that, man, keep your friends in check, man.
Keep your friends in check.
Yeah.
Do you have anybody that checks you?
Not as much as I'd like to be checked, if I'm being honest, but I definitely get checked from time to time.
Yeah. Who where is that checking coming in from?
Where does it come in from?
Yeah, is it from a friend, a father, a relative? Where does that come in from?
Definitely France, for
Friends.
sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Same here. I was gonna say outside of my aunt, who basically raised me with her husband, I would say that friends is definitely the individuals who check me for sure. So, and it's one of those, you have friends and then you have those friends that when they speak, you listen. So I definitely try to listen when they speak for sure above everything else. But yeah, so definitely sorry to hear you lost a friend. How old was your friend?
Man, he turned 22 3 weeks before he passed.
22, man.
Yeah.
So YouTube, side hustles, things of that nature, grinding on your IT, man of the house.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you got your dreams unwrapped. Took a couple losses. What is one thing that, if you could give anybody advice on, what would that be? Just anything. Just, hey, this is something that I know. This is something that I experience. And if I was XYZ age or again, or if I could do this differently, do X, Y, and Z, what would that be?
I feel like the biggest piece of advice I give anybody, for real, is to figure out what you want to do as early on as you possibly can. And if that means you still have to try to, do things to see what's in the cards for you, then so be it. Because life keeps going, no matter how long you put something off, no matter how much time you think you have,
Yeah.
it keeps going. There's no stoppage. And had I focused on the reality of my situation a little bit earlier, just kind of saw some kind of progression, I'd probably be in a different spot now,
Okay.
in a better spot. I'm in a good spot. I could just be in a better spot, no matter, just got to keep working, keep hustling.
One question I did want to ask is when you were put in a situation where you had to basically be the man of the house, was it something that you ran towards and accepted that role? Or was it something that it took a little while for you to grasp that, oh, okay, by circumstance and happenstance, I have to ascend to be in this position and to be and act this way and more mature faster?
If I'm being completely honest, I didn't like it at first, just because it felt like it was depriving me of not having any responsibility. And I talk with a lot of my friends now, how we we joke about wanting to be young again, yeah. back in middle school, elementary school, where we didn't have to worry about anything. We just played video games all day.
Yeah.
So in a sense, that's why I didn't like it. But after a little bit, you know, I've accepted it and come to terms with, you know, regardless, if it's not now, I'm going to have to start looking things different later. If I'm doing this for us, I'm going to have to do this for myself later. So a little bit of hate in the beginning, got love for it now.
Okay. One thing that I went to a military high school, and there was this one individual, Master Sergeant Bailey. Two things he used to always say is learning is a change in behavior, which is something that I still carry with me to this day, right?
Yeah.
And the other thing that I felt is so profound that he used to always say is that the only way people change is when they're forced to. And that's something that, like yourself, I not necessarily ran away, but it took me longer to have to change to ascend into the man or ascend into those specific roles that I needed to be in.
Gotcha.
And it's, again, like some of the things that you touched on already, like, hey, I don't want to have to take on this responsibility so early on because I still want to be a kid or I still want to do certain things. And as you get older, and again, like yourself, you start realizing, okay, by circumstance, I'm going to have to either way because I'm forced to have to change. So again, through that, you learn very quickly, like, okay, no matter what, I'm still going to have to change because irregardless, this is happening.
Right.
And I felt like now, as I'm becoming more of a mature man in my life, that I'm picking that up quickly. Like, okay, don't shy away from the adversity. Just run right towards it, right? And I still struggle with that today, right? 27, and there's certain things that I'm just like, I don't want to do, but point blank period, I have to. What would you do differently? If you could change anything.
Anything? See, look, I don't know how I feel about that question because I want to say I live this life with no regrets.
Okay.
But there are definitely a couple of things that I wish I could have done different, you know, for a better outcome.
Things like?
Man. My friend who died. Mm. So just to give you a little bit of context, you know, I met him like maybe 6 years ago. And I met him dealing with this girl, my first love, quote, okay. at the time. And we wasn't really rocking with her. And this isn't off no Will Smith stuff, you know, just keeping it honest. It's more so.
See, I was both talking to this young lady. I'm just playing. So you were talking to a young lady. You guys were both, you met him prior.
No, because I was talking to her in, they family, you know, step siblings or whatever the case.
Okay, so.
She was acting a little wild, like towards both of us. So we just said, you know what, we're not messing with her no more.
So hold on, she was a little wild towards her stepbrother?
Yeah.
Because
the way that we was, how we were interacting with each other, we were cool.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, she just didn't like some of the stuff that we were doing together.
Okay. You're saying wild in the respects of just her approach, meaning like, hey, what are y'all doing this loud, wild like that? Or
you gotta elaborate. She came off a little too strong. Like, we were just hanging out, but there were some things that she saw both of us doing. It sounds a little wild now that I'm mentioning out saying it out loud, but it's not what you think it is. We were just, you know, hanging out casually.
Okay.
And she saw us doing something that you know, she didn't like. And at the time, just tell you what it was, so you know the viewers don't get messed up ideas or anything.
Yeah.
You know, we were smoking cigarettes at the time.
Okay.
You know.
That is wild.
Do I smoke now? No, but you know we was young, like ain't nobody. We was just being young and dumb.
Understood.
And the way that she went about, you know, handling that was very immature and very toxic.
Okay.
And it's something that I didn't feel like was appropriate given the circumstance, and then we ended up falling out later over something completely different and still toxic, but we became cool after that, and known him for a little bit, hung out, and then he got locked up for some second degree assault charges.
Okay.
The charges should have been dropped. They weren't dropped because things out of everyone's control. And then he ended up doing 3 years in state prison. Hmm. And at the time, he just had a daughter.
Oh, okay.
You know, he was locked up for a little bit. While he was on the inside, he was learning the stuff and trying to pursue his education and whatnot. And, you know, also trying to learn all the rules of the game. He was reading about, you know, financial literacy, understanding all that good stuff. He read Rich Dad, Poor Dad by Robert Kiyosaki.
Yeah, famous one.
Yeah, just trying to really make sure that he made the best of his time when he got out. And I don't want to say his father hasn't been active in his life. He is his father, but his parenting style, I don't know. I don't know what it was, but no one's ever been around long enough to have some kind of influence to tell him to, you know, calm down, to slow down a little bit. So after being locked up for 3 years and, you know, nobody still being young, you know, and at the time I had this kind of power over him because we were close. We bonded, you know, you know, we told each other, we loved each other.
When you spoke, he listened.
Right. And, so on that note, I had this power over him, same he did, you know, for me, and we kept each other in check. And we promised each other that, you know, over the phone and whatnot, and just our whole interaction while he was away. He got back, you know, I've been busy working two jobs. I couldn't really hang out with my guy as much as I'd like to.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm out here trying to work on my own progression.
Got real life responsibilities, understood.
Exactly. And he just got out, got his job, whoop, whatever. But since he's been out, no one's been telling him to calm down. You know, being away for 3 years, you know, he's going to, you know, party, he's going to drink, he's going to do that, this, that, and the third.
Yeah.
We hang out last 4th of July. You know, had good times. He did a couple of shots. To my knowledge, I thought he was okay. But he might have been a little, he shouldn't have been driving that day. We were supposed to go hang out at this spot, you know, with some of the friends I knew. I was going to introduce him to him because, you know, he's been away for so long. He ended up hitting the car and he ended up doing the race. Mm. And at that time, I felt like I should have talked to him.
Yeah. How soon from when he got out to when he passed? What was the time frame?
Couldn't be more than a year, man. Couldn't be more than a year. Not even a couple of months, if I'm being completely honest, because relating back to the previous situation, the only person that had the power to put him in check was me. I didn't say anything at the time, and I was like, you know what? You know, this is. I'm not gonna say anything. We're not gonna blow the night.
Yeah.
You know, let him be free. You know, he just got out. Let him enjoy it.
Do you blame yourself in a way or no?
Definitely did. I definitely do blame myself because just the people that he was around. You know, they were more enablers, if anything.
Yeah.
And I was more so the person who was giving out the reality checks.
The voice of reason.
Exactly. That was the last time I hung out with him. You know, I didn't.
It was the night before he passed.
No, 4th of July, because after a little bit, you know, I just been busy. We've been busy. He invited me out to, you know, go to a party to celebrate his birthday. I couldn't go because I was just working.
Yeah.
And then when I started this internship, like maybe like a month in, when I got out of work, I got a phone call saying that he passed. He was still, he passed in a motorcycle accident.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, that was tough, personally. Like, that was really tough for me because, I don't know. It's just, I blame myself because no one had him the way that I had him.
Yeah.
So, back to the question, if I could have done anything different.
He would have said something.
I would have said something for sure.
Hmm. He would have said something.
Because everybody else was saying the same thing. Oh, I didn't want to tell him this because he just got out, whatever. But
yeah.
Look where that got us.
Yeah. I understand that. It's almost in the sense of where it's like the guilt is in, hey, I know I should have and I didn't.
Right.
So understand that for sure. That I do. I definitely understand. Appreciate you for sharing that.
For sure.
Appreciate that for sure. That boy been cooking up some stuff during that.
Yeah, he was working, man. He was working. You thought he wasn't working right
now? I didn't think you were working.
He was working.
Didn't think you were working. But yeah, I think one of the more regretful things is just situations that I didn't be man about, right? Certain questions that I didn't answer when I just wasn't man enough to answer, right? So those types of things are things that, because like you, I try to live a life with no regret because every lesson has brought me to the point that I'm at now. But when I look back, it's just a simple fact of the matter is I could have handled things a lot differently than what I did. So definitely, definitely understand that for sure. That's probably, I think, one thing that I am working on now more than ever is I tell people, trying to be a man at all times, not just when it's convenient for me.
Not for sure.
And again, I've had my uncle in my life, right? A great father figure. But to not have your own personal dad, right, plays a little role. But again, at certain points in time, there's still no excuse for some of the, you know, things that I might have done, people I might have hurt.
I feel that.
But just, that was a really good move, too. Yeah, really good move.
Yeah, man. This is going to get real bad if I don't do something.
Mm-hmm.
Good, so do that.
You know you're gonna fuck up, right? Again, thank you for joining us for Conversations Over Chess podcast. We'll see you on the next episode. Thank you.
Nothing never comes to a sleeper but a dream. So I'm woke, try and get that money any means. Used to watch mom sweat them clothes to get them clean. Grew up in the slums, ain't shit that I ain't seen. And it's still free, all the guys till they free. Couple niggas crippin' and the others throwing bees. One thing for sure, they gon' all ride for me. Cause we ain't never phased, no gang family.
Intro. Forgot how I wanted to do the intro. Green light on?
Yeah,
okay. Took a couple L's, but we like to call those lessons. Coming from the burg, I was taught to pay attention. Custom snakes out hissing, and they'll sneak you in a second. For that, I keep a circle that be tighter than a virgin. Couple niggas screaming, fuck the law, ready for purging. Tell them let the 40 touch a nigga like it's flirting. A lot of hidden hate, oh, y'all thought y'all was lurking. But ain't no time to lack, nah, I'm always observing. Grew up in the field, but I never played the corner. Still could jam a nigga if I don't like the rowdy running. I've been underground running around like head tummy. Came from the bottom, I swear I started with nothing. So how can niggas hate? I swear to love it all be fake. Smiling in my face but wanna do me like I'm ace. That's why I say my grace before I put them on a plate. Cause I know I'm too important like a fucking uppercase. And life is like a race, it's just all about the pace. For a little money, dudes become a big disgrace. The fake come and go, but the real can't be replaced. They say the sky's the limit, only limit I embrace. And I'm about a dollar, no surprise I get the cake. Cause I was taught to hustle in any weather, cannot wait. I done had to starve just to make sure others ate. My pain versus your hurt is something that cannot relate. They try to lock the door, I kick that bitch like Kevin Gates. Couple roadblocks I ran through like I was free. Heart of a lion, I was molded by the apes. That's why I stand tall and never fall, ain't no debate. I'm on a mission, I gotta get it. For all them long nights, the oven had to heat the kitchen. For all them starving nights, I went to sleep just to forget it. No food, but the sink was always full of dishes. Check the refrigerator, knowing nothing even in it. Nights like that can turn a young boy into a menace. Same reason I don't give a fuck about no feelings. Cause I'ma be starving till I count 100 million. Part of my back, nigga.